About forums, last year of course we had a new Prime Minister and we're in the midst of an international financial crisis. This year's circumstances are somewhat different, but we've had a very significant budget in the last month, and I'm sure that will be one of the questions that we'll wish to address. In terms of the way we structure this evening, it will be somewhat different to last year. The first half, I'm joined by a panel on stage, and I'll introduce them in just a moment, and that'll help me in beginning the discussion with the Prime Minister for around 45 minutes. We'll take a 10-15 minute break, and then the Prime Minister and I will return and we'll have open mics from the floor to take your questions. If you don't wish to grab hold of the microphone in the second half and ask a question yourself, you can text us. Text SIS, which is a very innovative Christchurch company, have provided this screen next to me, and you can text a question to me and I'll see it over here on stage. A number of these flyers have been placed around the auditorium, which will tell you how to do it, so if you'd like to do that, please keep an eye on it. It might be easiest for everybody if you pop your cell phone on silent when you do that, because you do get a response, or you can leave it so we can hear what sort of a nice little tune you have. In terms of how we conduct ourselves this evening, I know there have been some protesters outside, and the Prime Minister, of course, wanted to get out of his vehicle and see them as he came in. I understand there are obviously some very strong emotions around Environment Canterbury, but I trust that you will join me in treating our Prime Minister with courtesy and respect down here in Christchurch. So to our panel, I'm joined again this year by Colin Espiner. Colin was the political editor for the press for 8 years, but this year he's joined us as an assistant editor here in Christchurch. He's responsible for our website and is one of our senior editors. So nice to have you back, Colin.
Nice to be back again, Andrew.
In the centre is Fiona Rotherham. I'm afraid we've brought an Aucklander down. My apologies for that. We thought it might be useful to have an Auckland view of the world. Fiona is the managing editor of Business Day, which is the Fairfax business group across the country. So it's nice to have you here, Fiona.
Thank you.
And normally I would describe the lady as the rose between two thorns, but given that you're standing beside two journalists, I think, Roger, you're probably the rose tonight. Roger Sutton, of course, is the Chief Executive Officer of Orion here in Christchurch. Welcome, Roger. Ladies and gentlemen, would you join me in welcoming to the stage the Prime Minister of New Zealand, the Honourable John Key. Last year's forum, our Mayor Bob Parker managed to extract out of you a commitment to spend something like $1 billion down here in Christchurch. What we didn't realise is that the cost of that would be the closing of your old primary school, the sacking of ECAN's councillors and the GST going up to 15%. So I think it's fair to say that we're not going to ask for anything this year. Can I ask you to begin the evening by spending 5 minutes or so, just reflecting on the past 12 months and how you see the country and your government's program?
Sure. Andrew, thanks very much, ladies and gentlemen. It's great to be back in Christchurch, and I thought I might start by hoping that you enjoyed your long weekend on Queen's Birthday. Quite a number of people have come up and remarked to me about the Queen's Birthday honours list, and in Auckland they're certainly talking a lot about the Mad Butcher getting a knighthood. Some are calling him Sir Mad Butcher, some are calling him Sir Peter Leach, but the best I'd heard was one this afternoon where they're calling him Sir Loin. I just took a little bit of having a quick look about the Canterbury region and to give you some sense of what you're dealing with down here. Putting one side that you buy a large margin, have the best Super 14 franchise in the country, you are the second to largest economic contributor in New Zealand. You're 15.2% of GDP. You've had four quarters in a row of GDP growth. You have an unemployment rate that's 5.5%, so you're below the national average at 6%. You have 32,832 people on a benefit, 9,300 on the DPB, 10,845 on the invalids benefit, 7,021 on the sickness, and 4,626 on the unemployment benefit. And you are the number one place I wouldn't recommend Andy Hayden came for a holiday. I just just want to turn to the budget. The budget had four interlinked ideas. How do we deliver economic growth? How do we reform the tax system so it's better, fairer and more efficient? How do we deliver innovation? And how do we cater with savings? I just make that point around savings because if you think about debt, and we worry a lot about that from an international perspective, take Greece for instance, terrible position, high levels of debt. That is debt at a government level. So when we came into office, and I was before you this time last year, the Treasury was telling us if we didn't change things in the budget, debt in New Zealand would be 50% of the economy and rising ad infinitum. What we actually did as a result of the changes in the budget last year was we got debt to top out at 37%, and in the latest budget we're now at 27%, so we're in good shape. But debt at an overall level, in other words, what mum and dad owes, if you combine that with companies and with the government, is close to 100% of GDP. So no country in the world, from an OECD perspective, owes more money to foreigners than New Zealand does. So that is a position we need to sort of think a bit about. What we tried to do in the budget was do a lot around tax reform, and I'm sure we'll get into more questions about this later, but essentially, let me just give you a few ideas. The first thing we wanted to do was have integrity in the tax system, because one thing the tax system wasn't before was fair, and that is that if you could book all of your income in a trust, you paid 33%, not the top rate of 39% if you're a high income earner. IRD, when they were looking at us, advising us, came to us and said, of the top 100 personal taxpayers in the country, only 50% of them pay the top personal rate. The second thing we looked at and said was, what would be the best design we could have? And we agreed that that would be the trust rate, the top personal rate, and the company rate all aligned. And for quite a while, we looked at the top company and personal rate of 30%. But it was our long-term view that we wouldn't be able to sustain company rates falling around the rest of the world and New Zealand not being able to match that. So in the end, we aligned the company rate with the top personal rate, the trust rate with the top personal rate, all at 33%, and the company rate with the top savings rate at 28%. The effect of what we did in the budget was quite interesting. Prior to the budget, if you earned under $228,000, you paid more tax in New Zealand than Australia. As a result of the budget, that number's now down to 55,000. So a substantial improvement in terms of competitiveness with Australia. If you think about who pays tax in this country, just to give you a perspective, if you earn $50,000 or less, have two children, you don't pay tax because of working for families. So very difficult when you're dealing in that space. And a lot's been made about the cut to the top personal rate. The reason we did that was we unashamedly want those people in our economy because of their skills, because of the contribution they add, and because of the tax they pay. The top 10% of taxpayers in New Zealand, personal taxpayers, pay 72% of all personal tax. So if they get up and leave, it's not just your doctor leaving and taking care of someone in Australia, it's not just your scientist leaving and undertaking scientific research in Australia, it's not just your engineer or your entrepreneur, it's actually 72% of your personal tax base walking out the door. So that was really what we tried to do around the budget. The second thing I want to touch on, if I could just have a couple more minutes, Andrew, is two other things, ETS and ECANS. I know that they'll come up in substantial debate, I'm sure, as the evening goes on. But let me just tackle the ETS, because if this is reflective of a lot of audiences around New Zealand, at the moment, the bulk of you will be having at least a high degree of anxiety or opposed to the introduction of the ETS. So let me tell you why we're doing what we're doing. Firstly, the overwhelming bulk of scientific evidence argues the case that climate change is taking place. We can have a debate about the merits of it, or otherwise there will always be a scientist who will tell you it won't happen, but then you can always find a lawyer who will tell you you'll win in court, and that's not always the case. But the overwhelming bulk of scientists believe climate change is happening. So then some people say, well, the cost is too great. This is the actual cost. It's $165 to you, a household, per year, $3.17 a week. So that's the insurance policy you're buying. It's about half of what the Labor scheme was that we inherited. Some people will say to you, well, why would we go into an ETS and be the only country in the world that's doing that? That's not true. Of the 38 countries who are who have affirmed the Kyoto Protocol, 29 of them have an emissions trading scheme. People then go on and say, yes, but our emissions trading scheme is much more draconian than, say, the European Union's one. That's not true. The European Union scheme covers 43% of all emissions in their economy, and ours covers 23%. People then go on and say, well, look at Australia. They've shelved their scheme. They're not doing anything. That's also not true. In the last budget, what they did was, in Australia, was they said, you have to produce, if you're an energy producer, 20% of all power from renewable energy by no later than 2020, and you have to start now. That meant power prices in Australia have started rising by 7.3%. We've estimated it to be 5.1% in New Zealand, but could well be less than that. Then the next issue comes where people say, but you're shipping all the money offshore. That's actually not true. We raise about $700 million over 2.5 years in the US, but we're paying $1.6 billion out to forest owners. So we actually lose, we being you, the taxpayer, lose $900 million in that. And the only other final point I'd make is we have a review in 2011. And when that review comes around, if the rest of the world isn't doing more, I'm personally of the view that they will continue to do more, but if they don't, then it's true. We won't bring forestry in, we won't continue the abatement regime that we have, and we'll take things a bit slower. But I don't think we're leaving the world enormously. And finally, if I could just make one last point really on ECANS, because I understand the significance of that. I think the first thing I'd say to you is that we didn't take that decision lightly. I know that people aren't happy about it, and there was a group of people outside protesting, and I acknowledge their right to do that. I'm sure plenty of people will have comments to say this evening. But firstly, there's no getting away from the fact that water is hugely important here in Christchurch. So, for example, 70% of New Zealand's irrigated land is in the South Island, 55% of all hydro is in the South Island. You are the only regional council that has not managed to have an operative plan in 19 years. So it took 9 years for NASA to put a man on the moon, and after 19 years, ECANS could not get an operative water plan here in Christchurch. If you go and have a look at who supported us, it wasn't a decision we made on our own. All 10 Canterbury mayors, Ngāi Tahu, Fed Farmers, Local Government New Zealand, Chamber of Commerce, the Environmental Defence Society, all asked us to intervene as the government. And in 2009, local government conducted a report on all of the local governments in New Zealand. ECANS ranked 84th out of 84. We took a step which is not necessarily the easiest step in the world, and replaced the council with commissioners. And you're right, for those of you that would say, get me back to a democracy, because we do need to get back to democracy, and we'll do that as quickly as we can. But I, for one, make no apologies for wanting to progress the issue of water in Christchurch and getting a balance between economic growth and the environmental conditions that we need to make sure that we sustain and hopefully improve. That's a plan which, let's be honest, would take 15 odd years, maybe longer. I mean, it's not something that's you can do in the short term, but this is how much you have to grow. Roughly 2% more on average every year than trend growth is in New Zealand. So in broad terms, depending on what measure you want to use, we grew at about 2% for the last 10 years. We need to grow at 4%. And to achieve that, you can't just do it by clicking your fingers and wishing one thing. I mean, you've literally got to go and fix infrastructure, you've got to fix regulation, you've got to fix your trade markets, you've got to improve your skill base, you've got to do all of those things, and you've got to do them in unison. So, no, I actually think New Zealand's in very, very good shape. I think we've got a competitive advantage on our company tax rate now. In Australia, we have an increasingly competitive advantage on our labour rates and on our tax position with Australia. But yes, they've got a very big mineral base. And
realistically, will we ever catch up?
I reckon we can. But I want to do it because New Zealand does better than Australia does badly. And I know a lot of people sort of want Australia to do badly as a reason for us to catch up, but the truth of it is they're our largest market, they're our biggest supplier of capital, and if Australia does badly, economically, New Zealand generally does badly. So we actually need Australia to do well.
Thank you.
what is the language around this, Prime Minister, though? Because I remember at one point it was a target, and then I heard Governor say it was aspirational.
It's an aspirational target.
It's an aspirational target. So where does that leave us in reality? I mean, it's on the level. I mean, Labour promised this once upon a time. They said we're going to get back in the top half of the OECD by, I think it was 2012 at the time, wasn't it?
Yeah, something like that.
They abandoned that.
Well, I've been saying to people, we are 22nd out of 30 countries for economic performance in the OECD. And I've been saying to people, well, virtually state my political career will go up. The reason for that is Greece is number 21. So it's not entirely possible to go past them. But look, you're right, look, it's an aspiration target. In other words, that's our aim. So a lot of people say to me, and I got it last night at a dinner I was at, just give up on Australia. You know, how do we compare ourselves against Australia? They're actually the lucky country. They've got a lot of minerals. They've got a lot of opportunities. No one's arguing against that. But this is the one reason we can't do that. Every one of you sitting in the audience tonight has a free option. Every single one of you can get on the plane and go to Australia if you want to. And I remember when I was at this forum last year, we were talking about the brain drain. Well, 1 in 4 New Zealanders who have been to university now live overseas. No OECD country has the level of brain drain that New Zealand has. And what's happening to us, in a way, is what's happening to the Pacific Islands. Very bright Pacific Islanders coming down to New Zealand. Bright New Zealanders going across the Tasman to Australia. And I want to reverse that position now. There'll always be people that go overseas and there'll be people that go and have and come back with much greater skills or capital, whatever it might be. But I just don't think we can afford to ignore Australia. And I actually think we can do better.
Just sticking with Australia for a minute, they've proven that, you know, high personal savings leads to a strong economy. We've got a really poor track record of that here. Your government has weakened KiwiSaver and it's stopped putting money into the super fund. So what about compulsory super? What's the downside to doing that? Why won't you go ahead?
Yeah, okay, so let's take firstly the savings rate. Actually, the funny thing in Australia is that savings rate is actually quite similar to New Zealand's at one level, and that is they have very high levels of private sector debt as well. So we are about 100% of GDP, so do they, so do the UK, so do Australia, so does the United States. So westernised democracies have been spending a lot of money. What is true in Australia is we have a pay-as-you-go system. So your taxes today go to pay for someone who's retired and over 65. In Australia, they pre-fund it. So they've got a pool of investable capital, $1 trillion plus sitting out there now. So they're saving in a slightly different way, but they have high levels of mortgages on their property. That's why they're, broadly speaking, their savings rates go the same. Yes, we did reduce, if you like, the amount that employers put into KiwiSaver, but we just simply couldn't afford to do it without it. And I think, given the financial crisis that we faced, we would never have be able to carry on the way that was earlier promised, which was on the back of much stronger conditions. But we have lowered taxes on savings, and we are looking to increase savings. In terms of compulsory, that is a perennial debate that comes up. It's a debate you can argue both ways. I'm not in the camp that says it has no merit. I think that it has done a lot to improve at least the depth of the capital markets and the ability for money to be put in companies in Australia, so I like that. And I like the fact that it's made Australians more financially literate. So when you get your statement every 6 months or whatever, it's given Australians a perspective of investing outside of just property. But in a way, they also don't have what we have, which is a universal superannuation at age 65. So I don't want to change that. And the question would be, could you have some modest compulsory savings scheme on top of it? The answer is yes, that's possible, but it's not something we've done any work on at this point.
Roger, your lovely wife's a journalist, so you know how hard it is to get a word in, so I'll copy you out here if I may.
Thank you. Good evening, Prime Minister. I was actually just going to carry on that with the sort of the savings and the finance area. A lot of people, probably a lot of people here have been really hurt by the finance company collapses. I bet I'd be surprised if many people here actually freely invest in the share market. If you actually look at, you know, whoever bought their KiwiSaver money, I think 80 or 90% of people are putting into very, very conservative type funds. And it just seems to me the government's just been incredibly weak in the response to the finance company collapses. In terms of, I think we're getting a super regulator, but this is what we really needed was a really, really fast, harsh response so people actually get the confidence when things do go seriously wrong in the finance sector. the big guys, you guys, are going to be there backing them and doing something to give people confidence to get out there and invest again.
Yep, so I think firstly, you're right, there needs to be confidence. So if mum and dad don't get confidence to invest, then they're simply not going to invest. And if you look at the investment, to give you an idea where you are investing, in 2009, investment in rental properties was total $200 billion. So you had $200 billion invested in rental properties. Money invested in the New Zealand Stock Exchange, $50 billion. Four times as much invested in rental properties as the New Zealand Stock Exchange. What there is in New Zealand is a very strong private, sort of equity private business market. So there are businesses that do incredibly well, but they're not listed on the stock exchange. They total about $150 billion. So there's no question we need to get confidence into people being able to invest into the stock exchange and ultimately investing in those companies. I don't want to go back and blame the previous government because it's easy to always do that. But if you go and have a look at the whole finance company sector, there's no question that the regulation in New Zealand was far too weak and New Zealanders weren't protected properly. And you can see that by the way that the Securities Commission and others did or didn't do their job necessarily well. So let's take Blue Chip as an example. There'll be people in the audience without doubt that have lost money in Blue Chip. They tried to issue a prospectus in Australia. It was rejected. But they're allowed to issue the same prospectus in New Zealand. So New Zealanders got to invest in something that was a very poor investment. Australia was protected from that. And I think there were a whole lot of different issues in there. So we can't eliminate market risk if you put some money in something that's just a bad investment. Well, that comes with investments from time to time. But where you're ripped off and actually treated very poorly and effectively there's a form of a great deal of dishonesty involved, then you're entitled to be protected from that. And I would say that the super regulator will do that. So in Australia, the equivalent is ASIC, and ASIC has been much, much more robust and aggressive in its action against white-collar crime, and it has been more proactive and been more effective. So my
you don't think we could have used existing institutions to be a hell of a lot stronger and a hell of a lot quicker to actually just give people confidence that, you know, they were going to be bad?
Well,
it would be interesting to ask the audience tonight, how many people here tonight, knowing we're going to have a super regulator, are going to feel relaxed about investing in finance companies or the share market in the future? You know, I think what people want to see is real action, real enforcement action, the way with the Commerce Commission have had a real go at the Fair Trading Act and taken prosecution, we've seen a real change in behaviour from companies. Are we looking for enforcement? Are we looking for action?
Yeah, okay, but if you go and have a look at those that have some responsibility around that, which has been the NZX, it's been the Securities Commission, from time to time it's been the Commerce Commission, there have been a number of other bodies that have had some responsibility, they either haven't been coordinated or haven't necessarily acted. And I would argue pretty strongly we do actually need to put that together in a coordinated way and give it a lot more teeth.
I was just going to say, I'm thinking here about how we could catch up with Australia, which is something that we've been talking about. And I'm thinking, isn't the obvious answer the one that Jerry Brownlee from the Sphere City has raised himself, which is dig the place up and sell it to the Chinese? I mean, if we take all the
crap... Well, when the Chinese are going, they don't necessarily want to dig it up, actually.
Well, I'll just come over
we'll and take come it to later on.
But, I mean, my point is, I suppose, that at the end of the day, that for all Australia's supposed sophistication, really, they are just lucky to sit on a huge amount of mineral wealth. Now, your government's been trying to explore that here, but I understand the reaction hasn't been terribly favourable.
Yeah, okay, so let's just take a step back on the mining debate and the whole resource sector for a moment. So, firstly, the important thing to understand is what you're sitting on, and the answer is a lot of wealth. So the OECD in Paris, they've gone away and looked on a per-person basis and said, show me the wealthiest countries in the world from a resource perspective. So resources measured against your population. Number one in the world, Saudi Arabia. Number two, little country you might have heard of, called New Zealand. So it's not Australia, it's New Zealand. Just to give you an idea, and I'm not proposing this for a moment, just for so if you look at Schedule 4, so Schedule 4 is the most pristine of conservation land. So that is the highest quality value conservation land. The estimate at the moment of the mineral wealth in that land, or under that land, is $190 billion. But the estimate is by the time you took it out over the lifetime of taking those minerals out, close to $1 trillion. So there's no question there's a lot of money there. Now, obviously, that has to be traded off against. You are talking about some of the most pristine tourist, visited high quality land in the country. So by definition, you actually can't necessarily go and extract that. Certainly not in today's world. So okay, we accept that. And when we asked the officials to tell us about that land and what the options were, they came back with 467,000 hectares that they recommended that we consider for prospecting. And as a government, we said, look, we're not interested in that, and considered 7,000 hectares. So it was a very, very modest proposal, albeit I accept that some people don't like it. And that included Great Barrier Island, Auckland, Coromandel, and Paparoa National Park in the South Island. But what I would say to you is, so I accept that, yeah, that's challenging. But if you just take a step back for a moment and talk about what does the rest of the resource base look like in New Zealand? Oil and gas earns about $3 billion a year from New Zealand. It's been steadily rising, and we've been doing very well. We think, with the right level of prospecting and the right level of interest, we, in a time frame of about 10 to 15 years, could get that to about $10 billion a year. So it's largely offshore oil and gas exploration. The second thing where unquestionably there's a lot of value, but again you've got to deal with some environmental issues, is lignite conversion plants. So largely at the bottom of the South Island, could turn into urea, which this proposal Ravensdown currently has with Solid Energy, or you could go and turn it into diesel, high, long-term, low-cost sort of form of diesel. Third area where there's unquestionably some capability is potentially iron sands. New Zealand very rich in iron sands. Again, quite a long way out to sea, a number of environmental issues. So my basic point to you would be to say, I don't know whether we're going to win the Schedule 4 debate, and I'll accept there's been a lot of noise about that, and that's something we need to tread very carefully on. In due course, I'll have some more comments to make about that. But I think New Zealanders should look at the totality of the resource base, because on the non-Schedule 4 land and on those other three areas, without doubt, we have the capacity to deliver a lot more wealth to you. And to me, you've got to achieve three things if you're going to expand your resource sector. One, you've got to deliver jobs. Two, you've got to make sure that you deliver the bulk of the money here in New Zealand. And number three is you've got to make sure you do it in an environmentally sustainable way.
Can I just jump in, John, and let me change your subject for hogging my mic? But I'm sensing that you are essentially saying that the Schedule 4 debate is lost. The government is not going to try and mine things that are in Schedule 4 or take things out of Schedule 4. Am I right?
Well, Cabinet hasn't made that decision yet, nor have I seen enough of the submissions that have come in at this point.
But that's your feeling?
Well, no, I wouldn't want to characterise it as that. Each bit has something different. So in the case of Barrier, there are real challenges about whether firms would want to go there, but there's unquestionably some mineral base. In the case of the Coromandel, it's a much more tricky debate around gold. In the case of Paparoa, there's a strong argument for taking it out of Schedule 4, because actually when it went into Schedule 4, that only happened recently in 2008, and the Department of Conservation actually argued about it going in. So I wouldn't carte blanche say we've lost that debate, I'd just say each of them.
So are you saying you'll do bits of it as opposed to what you've
Truthfully, the Cabinet hasn't had that discussion yet, but what I can tell you is we are going to have it fairly soon and we'll make some decisions fairly soon. But I don't think we should get hung up just on Schedule 4. I think you've got to take a step back and say, can we expand the resource exploration sector in New Zealand and achieve those three objectives? I think if we can, we should be doing it, because I think environmentally, economically, can add quite a lot of value.
You seem to back off as a government when you get opposition to things. Is there an issue that you're willing to bet your popularity on, that you're going to leave the country and say, I really believe in this, this is what I'm going to push through, no matter what anyone says? What is that issue?
Yeah, I don't know if I actually...
Sounds like you'd be willing to lose an election over.
It's a cheery thought, well, isn't it? Well, I must bring up one thing I can lose an election over. Okay.
You want to get to know you better. What are those issues you really feel passionate about?
Yeah, okay. So what I'd say to you is we have a number of those, and we've had quite a lot of them in the air. So for instance, if we go back to our budget, there was a lot of conjecture about whether we should drop the top personal rate, and about 12% of New Zealand taxpayers pay it. So if you just think about the numbers are not in your favour as a politician to drop the top personal rate. But my view is that we have to lift the aspiration of New Zealand. We want New Zealanders to be paying it because they're earning higher wages and they've got to face the right incentives. So one of the things we did in that tax structure, for instance, was two-thirds of the entire tax package went on the bottom two rates, and now three-quarters of all New Zealanders face a marginal tax rate of 17.5% or less. But we still, and I think it's worth cheering for it, because I think it really does give people the right incentives to be able to keep more money. In other words, they keep 82.5% of what they earn. But my view was that you had to deliver a structure which was going to give you the right incentives. So we actually did do a lot of things in that area. I mean, we came down to Canterbury and we accepted that some people wouldn't like what we did with ECANS, but for the future of what we thought was important for this area, we've done it. A whole lot of our supporters in particular don't like the emissions trading scheme, but I still think in 2 years' time we're going to be back here having this debate if we don't start tackling it on day one. So actually, are we backing away? Well, we've delivered a super city in Auckland against some fairly ferocious sort of debates. We've raised the issue around mining. So yeah, of course you've got to listen to people, and if you don't, I think when you stop listening to people, you are definitely going to get voted out. But I think what we are trying to prove is if we communicate with people, you know, by and large, even if they don't agree with us, we can sometimes carry the argument.
So what's the issue that you're willing to lose the election?
Well, economic growth is, look, in the end, my view, money gives you choices. You know, if you, it's no different from a household to a government. I mean, everybody wants to spend money. And every idea that gets pitched to me is a good one. You know, they always are good ones. There's always a good reason why we spend that money. And if you want to have confidence and you want to have choices, we've got to earn money. And that's why in everything we're doing, we are trying to lift economic performance in New Zealand. And as I said earlier, it won't be one individual thing. It might be, you know, a probationary period for companies with 20 employees or less. It might be building some infrastructure like Waterview in Auckland, which is not necessarily always popular in Auckland. It might be about reform of local government, as we've done in Auckland. But we're just going to systematically tackle those issues. And we're doing that with the core bureaucracy in Wellington.
Prime Minister, can I go back to savings? The government's made, I think, 100% return on KiwiBank. That sounds like a pretty nice little business. Why can't I have a share of that?
Yeah. So,
because at the end of the day, if you make a profit, it just goes back into a lovely government mix. I'd like a dividend at KiwiBank in my back pocket.
Yeah. So let's take a step back on asset sales. We made two commitments, I made two commitments before the 2008 election. First of those was no asset sales in the first term of this government. Not because I was ideologically opposed. I mean, I think you can put up a case for partial sales of SOEs. And I think there's pros and cons of it, but I think you can put up that case. But because, one, I didn't think it was a top order issue, and these things consume time. And secondly, we wanted to prove to people that we can keep our word. And I think if you go and have a look at what we've done as a government, we've kept our word. On pretty much everything I can think of, we've kept our word. It's not always easy, and there'll be some things that people don't like, but largely we kept our word. And we made that commitment, so there's not going to be any asset sales in this term. The second thing I also said was, I was never going to sell KiwiBank, and I intend to keep my word on that. Why do I think that's different from, say, potentially other SOEs, which may or may not have a partial sale? We haven't made those decisions yet, but we will, and when we do, we'll communicate up front with you, and you have a choice whether you want to re-elect us or not. And the reason for that is, in my view, KiwiBank basically is operating under an implied government guarantee. It's not real. Actually, SOEs do not have a guarantee from the government. You know, Solid Energy, New Zealand Post, you know, Meridian, they could all theoretically fall over. There's no guarantee we as the owner would bail them out. But the facts of life are that most people would say if a state-owned enterprise falls over, the government will come and rescue it. So in the case of KiwiBank, they had quite a large balance sheet, I think it's about $12.5 billion, off a relatively low amount of capital, at the point at which we sold some shares in that, we would either have to give that implied guarantee that's there to the private sector, or we'd have to put a lot of capital in to support that bank. And in my view, it's the least worthy of cases. Right. So I think it needs capital. But
does Bill English know? Because he was down here a few weeks ago, and he thinks it's a great idea. Yeah. Well,
no, he thinks that there is merit in partial floats of SOEs. I accept you used KiwiBank as an example, but I would argue with you the concept might be the right concept. Again, we haven't had that discussion, but we will. but the QVEC's not the right example.
So if not QVEC, what does likely be front runner? Energy companies?
Yeah, I don't want to speculate on it today because we haven't actually even sat around and decided that, but you can, all the valuers in the energy company, so I don't think it's a rocket scientist to say they would be more likely characters if we went down that path. But we would have to go away and say, yes, we want to do it, make the case to the New Zealand public and win an election.
Roger, I think you wanted to...
Health.
Health.
Yeah, I was thinking about health. You know, we're all getting older. Technology is getting better.
Yeah.
And all the health is getting a lot more expensive. I think we spend nearly half our health dollars already on the over 65s, which I'm not yet. But the issue is, how do we ration the health dollars going forward? You know, we just have this, you know, we just have this unsatisfiable demand around health. How are we going to make sure we get this value? How are we going to make sure we don't just spend money on the groups who can hold the biggest public meeting or can get the best soundbite on John Campbell or in the press or whatever? Yeah, what are we going to be spending money on? You know, how are we going to make those really, really tough decisions?
Yeah. Okay, so here are the facts on health. The biggest spending item we have as a government, $14 billion we're spending this year on health. So it is by far our biggest spending item, and there is insatiable demand for health dollars. Second problem you've got is that is the only area I can really think of where technology drives demand. So if you go out there and think of new procedures, then all of a sudden there's a demand for those to be funded. So as a good example, one of the things we did early on as a government was we fully funded Herceptin for New Zealand women. And I personally fully supported that decision. It was absolutely the right thing to do. I couldn't see why.
Although your officials argued strongly against
they
it.
They did.
The rationalists said it was a bad idea. Isn't that the example where we don't want to be politicising health? We're not just doing things that counter to the strongest minority, Prime Minister?
No, I think the officials were wrong and we were right. And the reason for that... Well, the reason for that was the bulk of OECD countries fully funded Herceptin for women.
But isn't that just because they've got a worse health model than we have, Prime Minister?
No.
They're not as disciplined as we are?
No, we have a good system under farming, and it largely generates very good prices. But look, as a country gets wealthier, the expectations of their citizens rise. So your expectations of a developed first world country is that you will have access to world-class healthcare. We actually, at one level, are doing quite well. I mean, I think, for instance, one of the big themes we've had is how do we move money from the back office and the bureaucracy of health to the front line? And we're actually starting to make some real progress here. For instance, last year, we undertook 134,000 elective surgery operations last year, 13,000 more than any year in New Zealand's history. And that was because we were moving those resources from the back office to the front office. We've gone out there on a program of bonding doctors, of bonding midwives, of bonding nurses, and keeping them in New Zealand. So there's no question that we have to think more creatively because we have an ageing population. I mean, just to give you an example, the average woman in New Zealand dies at 82 and the average man dies at 79. I'd hasten to add, if you're above the average, do not panic. That is the and it's going up 2.5 years for every decade. So if every 2.5 years is going up another, for every 10 years, it's going up another 2.5 years. To give you an idea of what westernised democracies are dealing with, I was in the car with my son some years ago, and he said to me, "Dad, how old will I be when I die?" And I said, "Max, is that a reflection on the way I'm driving?" He said, "No." And I said, "Well, you go and work it out. The average man in New Zealand dies at 79, goes up 2.5 years by every decade. The answer is, my kids, on probability, will live to 100. So you think about that, there's a lot of years to consume health dollars. So your point is absolutely right. So we need to get to a point where we are going to consume more dollars in health, and we have to drive greater efficiency. And I think some of the sorts of things we're doing, let's take the 21 DHBs. We've rationalised two, Southland and Otago have come together. We've said to all of the others, all of your back offices have to work together, all of your purchasing agents have to work together. We have to reduce the bureaucracy that's sitting in the central Ministry of Health. We're doing that. And we're making sure that we are pumping as much as we can into either medicines or frontline services. The other thing I'd say we have to do is we have to develop these integrated family health clinics so that you can go to your health clinic, let's say, Bishopdale, and instead of having to go to hospital for a small operation, you'll have everything from a physio to a doctor to a to small doctor with a specialist ability to do that surgery for you. Much, much cheaper than going to hospital.
Prime Minister, can I, because I know time's short, and sorry to jerk around subjects here, but I am interested in race relations. It was an area that you, I think, singled out as one of the areas where you really wanted to make progress, and indeed you felt you were. I think this seems to have been either placed on the back burner or you have reached an impasse with the Maori Party. We haven't heard much about the foreshore and seabed, for example, recently. How are things going in that area? And how are things
well,
the Maori Party?
For us.
How's the Maori Party?
Good. Kia ora. They pass their regards. Look, this has been my view. When we put together the government in 2008, we didn't need the Maori Party to put together a government. So on the night, we knew we had the numbers because ACT rang up and said, even if you don't do a deal with us, we will give you confidence and supply. In other words, we'll vote for your budget. That's the test I have to have as a Prime Minister to the Governor-General. So the point at which I can bring the Governor-General and say, I have in 120-seat Parliament at least 61 votes. The Governor-General of the day says, OK, you are the Prime Minister. That's how it works. So why did we go and do a deal with the Maori Party when we didn't need to do it? Well, the answer was twofold.
Because you didn't trust ACT.
They
jumped too soon. I would have thought that'd be part of the element.
No, the answer was I thought it would give the government balance. So one thing is I thought if we were just solely with ACT, we'd get moved to the right. And bluntly, the bulk of New Zealanders inhabit the middle of the bell curve. You know, most people are middle New Zealanders, so they're not to the hard right and they're not to the hard left. The second thing was, so I thought it would give us balance. But the second thing was that I actually think we have to deal with some of these race relations issues. And again, if you want to go and look at the correspondence I get when I wind people up, it's largely on race relations issues. So they won't like things I do on the foreshore and seabed, or they don't like other things I've done around race relations, everything from flying the flag on Waitangi Day to the Declaration of Rights of Indigenous People. And again, I understand that. But this is my view, which is we're a country of 4.36 million people. And fundamentally, we have a very good record on race relations, much better than most other countries in the world. And whether we want to accept it or not, there are some real challenges in the Maori and Pacific community around some of the very negative stats that dominate the statistics that we would look at. So let's take education. Just to give you an example. If your kid leaves school in year 12, which is the sixth form, with NCEA level 2, that is the bare minimum your child needs to undertake an apprenticeship. One third of all Maori boys leave school without even NCEA level 1. Okay? So I went to Gisborne Polytech about three weeks ago. The number one thing they told me was half of the Maori boys that turn up, we can't even enroll them into apprenticeship because they can't read and write properly enough to fill in the form. So you might say, not my problem, don't care about it. This is a small technical issue. Within 20 years, one in two children who are in primary school in New Zealand will be of Maori or Pacific ethnicity. They are your future workforce. So in my view, we do actually have to build a culture which is both unified and tackling some of those issues. And I actually think we've got to get out of the grievance mode we're in and get into a much more positive, aspirational, forward-looking view. And actually, in that regard, the Maori economy is very powerful, and you're seeing that in Christchurch. Ngātahu is a big investor. So I actually think we did the right thing, and in terms of the foreshore and seabed, we're immensely close to a deal. I mean, as I've been saying all week on radio and TV, look, if the Maori Party won't vote for it, there's no point in us pushing through a foreshore and seabed bill. Because in the end, that wouldn't solve. I mean, in the end, if they're not happy, then what's the point? You know, I mean, it wouldn't be settled. But what I can say is there's also got to be bottom lines, and I'm not going to walk away from those bottom lines. So when Tuhoe said to settle a deal, I had to sign over a national park of over 200,000 hectares, the bottom line is that's a no, because they're for all New Zealanders. In the case of the foreshore and seabed, the 2004 law says it vests solely in the Crown. I've said I'm happy for it to vest in what's called public domain. And public domain is like the continental shelf. No one owns it, and no one doesn't own it. We all own it. okay? The second thing, as I've said, is, okay, if you want to test your rights in court, you can go and do that. But just remember that the Court of Appeal made it quite clear in the Ngāti Ata decision that that would be very hard to find customary title. So I'm not going to go and give away a whole lot of things which just legally and ethically don't stack up. But on the other side of the coin, I actually think it's incumbent on any Prime Minister to try and advance race relations. And I'm happy with the deal I've done, and if I was faced again in 2011, I'd almost certainly do the same deal again.
Panel, we've got time for one more question each, so Roger, I'll start with you.
Well, just a light one then. What's your, tell us about your best and worst day in the office so far.
The worst day was when Colin left. We all sat around and cried. What was the best day? What was the worst day? In a funny kind of way, every day has its positives and negatives. I mean, I am a pretty glass half full kind of guy, and to me, I'm not going to sit around and whinge about the bad days of being Prime Minister, because there are plenty of other people who want my job, and if I'm not positive and confident about it, then why on earth do I deserve to be in the job?
You still have hard days,
Yeah, I have hard days, I've lots of hard days. And that is when ultimately you see, in any decision you make, for a start off, it doesn't matter almost how good you think it is, about 30% of people disagree with you. So that's just your starting point. And then a lot of times you're trying to do things where I'm trying to communicate what I think are quite rational points that get condensed into a media soundbite that you see that might be a million miles away from the real truth or genesis of the story. So that makes life a little bit difficult. I think the hardest day I had was actually sending the SAS to Afghanistan. And the reason for that is there's no getting away from the fact that it is very dangerous, and if someone dies there, it's on my shoulders. I understand that. But on the other side of the coin, I actually believe in what I've done. I think that New Zealanders aren't immune from what happens around the world. In every major terrorist attack, whether it's 9/11, Bali bombings, London bombings, New Zealanders died. And all of those had their genesis born out of training camps in Afghanistan. And I think in the end, if we can't get on top of that position in Afghanistan, Al-Qaeda will come back and the world will be a lot more dangerous place. And you will ultimately be at risk. And I think New Zealand's got to play its part. But sometimes as Prime Minister, and a lot of times as Prime Minister, ultimately the responsibility falls on my shoulders, and I've just got to accept.
Best day?
The best day was the day we won. Surely you've won. Oh yeah, there's just something about that, it's sheer feeling of winning, it's great. It's the opportunity and what it meant to the potential to do something. But there's been a lot of good days. I mean, you just get to see a remarkable side of New Zealand. And, I just came forward, we've just named Michael Jones as the ambassador for the volunteer program for the 2011 Rugby World Cup. So we're going to ask about 5,000 people if they want to sign up and be a volunteer. Watch the small print, because you don't get a free ticket if you do it, but anyway. But they just showed a video on New Zealand, and I'm sure you'll see it across the TVs. But it really is stuff you just sit back and say, wow, it's amazing being a New Zealander. It's just an incredible country.
I wanted to ask about the Crave Farm, potential yep. Crave Farm sales, because obviously it's raised fears about the Chinese coming and buying up in New Zealand. So is government intervention the right or the wrong thing to do on this, or is getting Land Corp to buy them and then flogging off Land Corp to the public the right thing to do?
Yeah, okay, so let me just preface my comments by saying, because the way it works at the moment is if you're a foreigner and you buy land or an asset in New Zealand over a certain value, you have to go through what's called the Overseas Investment Act, which is administered by the Overseas Investment Office. And they are a group of people who sit around and say, have you met the criteria? Have you fulfilled what's required? Are you worthy of undertaking this investment? So let's take Shania Twain when she bought her property in central Otago. She would have had to go through that process because it was a certain value and a certain size. So, in the case of the bid by the Chinese to buy the Crayford Farms, that is before the Overseas Investment Office, and they are independent of us as the government, but they make a set of recommendations which ultimately goes to two ministers, and those two ministers have to decide whether they're going to accept or reject that recommendation. So I'm in a very difficult position because if I say too much, I could be seen as influencing that outcome. and so I've got to be cautious. But so let me just make broader comments on the overall theme, and that is to say, I don't think as a country we can just be ambivalent about people coming in and buying up New Zealand. No, I really don't. I think that in the end, I personally think the next 10 to 20 years could be the most powerful economic years that New Zealand's had in, quite frankly, a century. And that's because of what's happening in China. I mean, just the demand out of Asia, but particularly China, is going to be colossal. So, for instance, we think there will be a 50% increase in demand for food in the next 20 years alone. I mean, it's just going to be enormous. And don't we, from New Zealand's perspective, want to own that future? And we have the best technology in the world, we have the best farmers in the world, we have a great marketing system, we have a great co-op in terms of Fonterra and lots of competitors around that now. So to sell all of that out would leave us in a position where we would just make our current account worse, we'd become sort of tenants in our own country. So I actually don't think we can just sit back and say, we don't care about this stuff. On the other side of the coin, what makes it really, really challenging is, if someone comes in and buys one farm, I don't really care what their ethnicity is, then probably we're not too bothered. But at what point is it too many? Is it 16, is it 4, is it 5, is it 11? I don't know. But I, for one, just don't think we could sit back and say, I wouldn't care if in 20 years' time the entire South Island was owned by the Chinese, because I personally would.
Is Land Corp an answer?
It could be. They haven't approached us formally, but that doesn't mean that they're not looking at it.
Come on. I'd like to take you back to something that you said when you first became Prime Minister. You're a child of the welfare state.
Yep.
In fact, you're from here. You grew up here, and you knew hard times as a child. The Greens had their annual conference here last weekend, and they accused you of abandoning those roots. I'm sure you've read the stories.
Yep.
They said that you had turned your back on your upbringing, essentially. I guess I'd just like to know what there was in the budget, or what we can actually see that you're doing at the moment, which goes to show that you haven't turned your back on those people.
Yeah, okay, so first things first. In the period since we've been the government, in 18 months, we have been borrowing $240 million a week. It's not necessarily a number I'm hugely proud of, but we have been borrowing $240 million a week. And the reason we've been doing that is because we wanted to insulate New Zealanders from the rough edges of the recession. In other words, we wanted to continue paying benefits, we wanted to have some effectively make work schemes, we wanted to do things to keep people in the best position that we could. So if we were abandoning our belief in people who are less well off, we'd be saying, hell with that, that's an easy thing to cut, they're not necessarily our voters, we won't care about, we haven't done that. Second thing is that if you look at those people that are on welfare, so there's an interesting story on TV1 walked out tonight. So they were saying, this is the welfare stats in New Zealand as they reported them. I think they're about right. 325,000 New Zealanders on a benefit, 1 in 8 adult New Zealanders. 178,000, I think, roughly, have been on it 7 years or more. So it's a lot of New Zealanders. So the question is helping people on welfare and doing the right thing by them, is it just continuing always to support the system the way it's been, or is it doing something to actually try and get them off welfare? Because I'm personally in the latter camp. Because I don't think, I mean, Michael Joseph Savage, when they first brought in welfare, said, make no mistake, it's not an armchair ride to prosperity, and it's not. So let's just take the budget. The budget said, and this is Treasury's advice, that all the things we did were so economically strong it would add 170,000 jobs. That's the reality of the budget. It delivers, as I say, a tax rate which is 17.5% or less. It means that if you earn 50,000 or less with two kids, you pay no tax. And then you go and look at things like, let's just say, home insulation here. You know, we've been rolling out the biggest home insulation program New Zealand's ever had. We are going to insulate 4 times as many homes as Labour did in a quarter of the amount of time. So I think if you go through all of the different things we've been doing, nothing in the budget I accept directly narrowed the wage gap between the rich and the poor, but nor did it make it worse. But what it did do is it put better incentives in the economy for people to get off welfare.
Are you happy with that, though? It sounds like Rob Muldoon, what did he say? I don't want to leave the country in
any worse shape.
I found it. I mean, isn't that what you're saying?
Yeah, no. I tell you what, this is what I think, and if you want my purely party political view, of the differences between the parties. I want to narrow the gap between the rich and the poor, but I want to do it by making the poor wealthier. And I personally think the left often want to make the rich poorer. I accept that's a compliment.